this sort of gets into sort of more of our conversation of like, where do we get inspired from? So what's really interesting to see is that jewelry in itself is one of the areas that people feel that they can actually get to easier when they're looking at being aspirational. So Luxury Daily did a great study that showed in information on Instagram and Pinterest, and shows how much more people feel they can connect with jewelry, especially watches, because sort of that easier to attain portion of life. So I think we should talk a little bit about how do people discover today? And I think we probably could all agree with this, though we may not always like it, but 60% of today's customers buying begins online. So what does this actually mean for each generation? So let's start with you, Deep. You know, if the journey begins online, where is it starting for Generation Z and millennials?
Right. So with Generation Z, and even most millennials, I think Instagram is a huge platform. Every time you go on Instagram, scroll through like 20 posts, you can't avoid seeing either a friend posting a new picture of whatever they just bought, or an influencer wearing something, advertising something for a company. And another really big side is Pinterest. Like, I think every time a woman goes on there, they spend 90 minutes at a time, which is kind of insane. So that's a big platform as well.
So, how about you, Scott? What do you think?
Well, it's interesting. I think of retail in a similar way that I think of how newspapers digitally have changed. The notion of going to the front page of a newspaper doesn't really exist anymore online. For consumers sort of across the board, everything that we access is through another channel that offers some level of curation. Whether that's Instagram, whether that's Facebook, whether that's through a newsletter or what have you. I think more and more it's a sort of like distributed notion of how information is sort of parsed out over the internet. And so in order to sort of meet your consumer where they are, you need to understand who they are, where they're likely to spend their time, and then begin to offer those experiences to them that start to sort of push them down that purchase path. While it might not necessarily be something that ultimately is driving to a shopping cart, if it's helping them move further along those lines. And so, in the same way that Deep mentioned Instagram, Pinterest, etc., I think understanding where your customers are likely to spend their time. And you know, even more so thinking about I'll probably jumping ahead on the conversation a little bit, but the notion of influencers is huge for this marketplace now, especially the younger generation. The sort of notion of a celebrity has completely changed, and the sort of trust and authenticity that comes alongside someone that is likely closer into that consumer is a huge boon to how those products sort of get moved throughout the marketplace. And then one other thing I would say is sort of in the currency or in the economy that we live in now, there's a sort of notion that if something isn't shareable online or in some easy way, then it might as well not exist. Because it's really about creating that sort of that amplification, that second life, that third life for this content to sort of move and really sort of build on your brand experience.
And I want to get into influencers a little bit in just a second, but I just want to stay focused on this topic for 1 minute, which is, you know, the fact that we do look online before we decide to buy. But, you know, data does show that people still prefer to shop in stores versus online because they do like to try things on. And you know, jewelry is one of those tipping points right now. And the better the e-commerce sites are getting, they're gonna start to tip a little bit more online. But just a little bit of understanding about what's going on with Google. Google Retail reports that 75% of today's local mobile searches are because people are looking to find prices. And if your stores aren't showing prices on your website, it's gonna be really hard for them to want to walk into your store. 74% of people are looking online to find what's in stock locally. So I love the example you gave about the no pressure experience, but for those people who are looking for that, I wanna shop instant gratification, they're looking for the local stores to do that. And then 66% of people are actually trying to find stores near them on Google. So, you know, when we talk about the discovery of brands today, I always say there's two sides to that. There's those who are discoverers and those who are already aware of you and now they're seeking you out. So as stores today, we have to balance the two of them. So with that, let's talk a little bit about influencers. And, you know, for me, I've known influencers for years. Influencers for me have always been, you know, someone in business who you listen to, or someone from a fashion sense, or makeup. I've talked about this a lot, like Michelle Phan did blew up on YouTube because of makeup. So let's talk a little bit about influencers. Tell us a little bit about, you know, what is an influencer to your generation? Is it always a celebrity or is it something else?
So the way I define an influencer is basically anyone who influences your buying decision. And with millennials, I think it was celebrities. They look up to celebrities as in TV stars, movie stars. And with Gen Z, anyone under 21, basically they look to influencers, almost micro celebrities, vloggers on YouTube. Anyone who's not quite that celebrity status, but more reachable. I think that's why younger people like influencers, because they can relate to them more than they can relate to like The Rock or somebody.
John, how about from your perspective, let me take this a step further. So we understand who an influencer is. How can stores, most of the stores don't have access to a celebrity per se, how can they find influencers in their community that can help them?
Well, just one note on the Rock comment. After I went to the gym, I was feeling like I was related to him for at least just a small second there. I think, again, it's tough. The thing with influencers is there's that fine line that sort of or this gray area in the marketplace right now, where there's sort of loosely defined rules about whether something is truly authentic, someone is freely choosing to sort of share a brand experience or a product purchase or what have you, versus these sort of paid spots. And so just to sort of put that on the table and recognizing that it's a difficult sort of dance to sort of do. That said, I think in terms of best practices for sort of locating these individuals is really sort of I guess the sort of general way of thinking about this is starting to understand who the people are that you're trying to reach. And some of this can be like strictly from a sort of data point of view. There's services now that are popping up that are starting to create almost a marketplace for these influencers that say, this individual reaches X, Y, and Z. But again, in terms of that sort of natural organic reach, I think it's a matter of inviting consumers in, particularly in a physical retail space or at an event situation, and giving them the tools and the opportunity to actually begin to share things in a more natural setting. And I think it's not the best answer, but I think it's just sort of putting as much sort of content into the marketplace, understanding the things that are gonna resonate. And then I think for me, the content that's really interesting is, again, those you have that expertise and people are looking for that expertise, and they seek out brands that provide a level of relevance and utility to them. And I think it's a matter of finding those things that align with your brand or with your store, and then seeding that into the marketplace and seeing what actually gets picked up by people.